Good morning, everybody. This is the Heritage Radio Bible Class from Walnut Grove, Minnesota. And it's our privilege to have and put on these broadcasts here and study the Bible together. Thank you so much for your response. It's just a privilege to be able to get these things out, because much anymore it seemed to be that just not many preachers preaching on prophecy or some of these things here that, some of the other side of the road, and that is they are preachers and so forth, but as far as preaching the Bible, they're preaching what their denomination tells them to preach, and we don't do that, and so forth. But anyway, let's continue on here, because we're in the Bible here about created and made concerning Adam and Eve, and then I want to go on over, and I hope we get through this here this morning, because I can't wait to get to the next part that we want to cover in this. And that is, you're coming out and saying there was no sin before Adam. No sin before Adam and Eve at all. And we just want to point that out, that truthfully, just to be sort of, I should say, right to the point, that how can you be that stupid when you go to church and you got a Bible that refutes all of that? What about Satan and so forth? But I don't even want to get on that until we get to it. Because it is so overwhelming that with your ignorance that it exposes, and we're going to bring it out for you so that you will know. But it's really a shame to have that kind of people that preach and don't know enough about the Bible to preach it right. So we're going to continue here, as we've been on this for quite a while, with the thing of created and made. And so we're going to take it and remember that bara is created, meaning something that never previously existed before. Asa, which is talking about something when you use that word. It is talking about something that has been used before, but not as a unit. It talks about pieces of things that has, and you put them together and have it, and that's what that word Asa means it like that. Now, both created and made are used in reference to Adam and Eve. Now, that's something. How would we have both of them for Adam and Eve? That's what we're going to see today. And the question naturally arises, how can we reconcile the two words as pertaining to God's creation of Adam and Eve? Before we examine the verses that use this, created and made, let us again look at their respective meanings, because these people of a young earth know nothing about the meaning in the Hebrew now of created and made. Created, we're going to just keep this down, because you got to have it or you're never going to have this right. You're going to stay on a young earth, which is absolutely a fallacy. The fact of a young earth is only young because he created it, but there was created on this earth prior to this coming out and saying, it's probably, 6,000 years old. Well, you're forgetting, where do you think the angels came from? Where did they go? Did he create them and then they just fly around in the sky somewhere? No, he created them and created the earth for them to dwell on. And that's what the Bible teaches. So, created, I want to show it again to you. Keep it in your mind, because if you don't know this, you'll have wrong teaching when you come about. Created, Hebrew, bara, B-A-R-A, showing us that God created something that never previously existed in any form whatsoever. Never existed. Made, that Hebrew word is asha, A-S-A-H, and the word means to release from restraint, to make, to allow, or to assemble. In the making of Adam and Eve, this would apply in the material, that's the physical sense, as well as their spiritual makeup. So that's how we want to bring this out to you. And then we're going to get on to where I can't wait. Maybe I should have jumped over this and went to that. But when you say there was no sin before Adam, and it's so stupid, I'm going to say this and I'm going to get back on this here. And I thought Eve, I thought Eve was sinned before Adam. Isn't that right? What are you idiots out here doing saying you're just going to teach the Bible and say there's no sin before Adam? You're an absolute idiot.
No.
You don't know your Bible. But I'm not going to get on that yet, but I hope I can get through this so I can start and get it on it for next week, because I can't wait. I think it's a good one. So anyway, we're going to examine the verses that contain both words in reference to Adam and Eve, and they're found in Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 and 27, and also in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7 and 22. So we're going to go right down through these four verses here, and we'll give them to you right now. In verse 26, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness." So God created man in his own image, and God created he him, male and female created he them. In Genesis 1, 27, that's verse 27. Now we're coming to Genesis chapter 2, verse 7. "And the Lord God formed man out of the dust of the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul." Now, in Genesis chapter 2, verse 22, "And the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made he a woman and brought her unto the man." Now, we're going down with this here. "Created mankind with sexual abilities to reproduce, God's angels on the original creation were all men. Mankind has never existed before at any time prior to Adam and Eve." Mankind. Notice in Genesis chapter 1, verse 27, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created them," or he them. They never existed as human beings, as men, in the original creation, because number one, they were all men, and none of them could reproduce, because their bodies didn't contain the reproduction things as we have with a man today, or so forth, because they were all men. There was no reproduction, there was nothing, they weren't equipped, they weren't made with a body to reproduce, and therefore there were nobody on the original creation but all men, and God had created them. "Created mankind has never existed before at any time prior to Adam and Eve." Notice Genesis 1:27, which reveals to us by the use of the Hebrew word bar, created, that God has never previously created anything in his likeness or in his image, such as a human being. Now, when we say that, you say, well, the angels were created. Well, sir, there was nothing like a human being. The angels were created with no facilities in order to reproduce. And they were all men. There was no women angels. Have you got that down? Now, put it in your little notebook so you can go back and look at it and say, yes, I listened to Pastor Yass. There was no, absolutely no women on the original creation. They weren't created. Now, if you don't know that much, you might as well hang it up and go set into the closet somewhere, because this is what the Bible teaches. Now, created mankind, as we said, has never existed before at any time prior to Adam and Eve. That is, with sexual abilities to reproduce. God's angels on the original creation were all men. So, anyway, let's go on. We find out the image of God that man possesses is not the physical appearance of God, for God is spirit. They that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. Rather, therefore, they are the spiritual qualities that a thinking, intelligent human being possesses, such as the mind, personality, emotions, conscience, and so forth. Other terminologies for these are labeled heart, soul, and spirit, along with sexual abilities to reproduce with both men and women. That's quite different from what is on the original creation. Now we're going to take the heart, the seat of your conscience and reasoning, in Romans chapter 12, verse 15, says this, "which show the work of the law written in their hearts, their conscience also bearing witness, and their thoughts," the meanwhile accusing or else excusing one another. Mark chapter 2, verse 6. But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning with their hearts. Now we come, what about the other? The soul. This is something that we all have. The soul is the seat of one's emotions, that's their feelings and appetites. Our soul can hate, 2 Samuel 5:8. It can mourn also, in Job chapter 14, verse 22. It can rejoice in Isaiah 61 in verse 10. And we find out that it can suffer. It does that with our soul, it suffers. Genesis 42, 21. Then it can be sorrowful and has sorrows. Mark chapter 14, verse 34. And it also has desires in Deuteronomy chapter 12 in verse 20. Now we come to the spirit. It was body and soul, now the spirit. The spirit is the seat of one's intelligence. 1 Corinthians 2:11 tells us this. For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the spirit of God. Also, verse 4. Therefore it is made perfectly clear by the use of the Hebrew word bara, that God has never previously created any species of Homo sapiens. In Psalms 115, verse 16, the Lord lets us know that the heaven, even the heavens, are the Lord's, but the earth has He given to the children of men, and that is for remodeling the earth for human beings. The difference between animals and humans. And we bring this out because I've had this so many times, and then there were some pastors that came out, can't remember who they were now, it's been a long time ago, and said, well, and how many are having their dog or their cat, where they have them, you know, well, I'm trying to think of the word here, Joey, but they have them, taxidermed, yeah, that's fine, but they have them to where they have their dog or their cat or so forth and still have it in the house there, but it's, made up, yeah, and so forth. But anyway, the difference between animals and humans. God has made it clear to the evolutionists that mankind possesses something that animals do not possess and never will. And it is called, Mr. Evolutionist, a spirit, which is your intelligence. In Job chapter 32, in verse 8, states this, but there is a spirit in man, and the inspiration, that is, of God's Word, of the Almighty, giveth them understanding. That's very, isn't it funny how God just answers these little things here, and He has it in the Bible here, you're supposed to pick up on them when you read it. We find in Psalms chapter 32, verse 9, that animals do not possess a spirit of intelligence and reasoning or understanding such as humans possess. Now, where do we find that? Well, in Psalms chapter 32, verse 9. It says here in that verse, be you not as the horse or as the mule which hath no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with the bit and the bridle, lest they come near unto thee. Now, I'll just give you one example about this. My friend, a good friend of mine, went up to visit some friends that some other friends had, and anyway went up there. I forget what the reason was now. But they had horses, and so we asked him, said, do you ever ride a horse? Said, oh, they love to be ridden. Well, I said, do you have saddles? Said, oh, you don't need a saddle. And said, they're just, you know, they like to be ridden. They have, we ride them a lot of times. So she said, going out there and go ahead and ride. Hop on one or get them to come over to you. So we did, my buddy and I. Worst thing I had ever done in my life. He got on his, good, there's no problem. And he was just starting to walk on down a little bit, so there happened to be an old table out there, I guess where they used to eat on it or something, but it was, you know, no good. But I thought, boy, that horse here that I got, he's a pretty good sized horse, you know, so. Anyway, I led him over to where the table was, and then I got up on the thing there where we sit, you know, and that made it much easier for me to get on there, you know. I didn't want to get halfway on him taking off down the field. But anyway, it turned out the same way. Anyway, I got on and he did turn down, and down the field he went. So anyway, he didn't go anywhere. And my buddy yelled, "Well, just give him a couple of heels in the ribs and he'll go." Oh boy. That's exactly what I did. I just took my 2 feet and, you know, I just go back there. You know, I said, "Giddy up, giddy up." Well, he wasn't moving when I was just saying, "Giddy up, giddy up." But when I did that back with the ribs with my 2 heels, he took off. He about threw me off, taking off. And here we are, clear up here and clear on down here, which would be, oh, I would say from this street here, clear over to the other street on the parallel with this one. And oh my goodness gracious, I'm saying, "Hold it, hold it, hold it, stop it, stop, 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 hey, 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 whoa, buddy, whoa." I mean, I was doing everything to get this thing to stop. I said, "Oh, no, I don't know what he's going to do that. He's going to run right down there when that fence is there. He's going to put on the brakes and he's going to throw me over him and right over there." That's what he tried. But what I didn't thought, I thought, "Well, I'll tell you what, bud, if you're going to do that, you're coming with me," which was stupid thing because he wasn't coming with me. But sure enough, I got down there and boy, he put the brakes on. But in the meantime, if you do that, if you're going to do that, I knew when he got down there, I thought what I better do. So I just swung on around and got underneath him. Here he is, and here I am right there face to face with that dude, you know, and I got my legs around his neck. And so he stopped right there. Oh my goodness gracious sakes alive. And I'll tell you what, he had a mind. And I don't know what made him do that or anything, but that's the last time I ever asked somebody to ride a horse or anything. I was so glad to get off that thing, I walked him all the way back. I wasn't going to get on anything. And I told my buddy, and here he's just riding. He said, "Well, what did you do to him?" I said, "You just gave him a little kick in the ribs like you told me to." And I said, "Man alive, he misunderstood it. He thought I was going..." Well, anyway, this is what happened. And it all scared me to death. I mean, I'm down at the fence when he stopped, and I'm underneath him, nose to nose here, upside down, and my feet wrapped around his neck. Whew. Man alive, I just didn't want him to throw me over the fence, you know. So I was hoping it'd slow me down or something, but anyway, I got back, and I learned something about a horse has a mind of his own, you know. But I'll never do that again. But anyway, animals do not possess a spirit of intelligence or reasoning nor understanding such as humans possess. Boy, that's true. I can't say that's there because he did not want to do what I wanted him to do. I just wanted him to trot along and he just stood there. The only way I got him started was to do what my buddy said, was just give him a little kick in the ribs. Whew! I'll never do that again. "Being not as a horse and a mule which hath no understanding, whose mouth must be held in with the bit and bridle, lest they come near unto thee." I am sorry, Mr. Evolutionist, but I just cannot buy into your pseudo-philosophy. Pseudo means your false philosophy that we slip from slime or come from scum, and so forth. Now, I'm sorry again, but again, God says of the evolutionists in Psalms chapter 14, verse 1, "Only the fool has said in his heart that there is no God." Now we continue on and we go back to the difference between man and animals. And animals have a soul with emotions and appetites which is connected with their bodies. They do not possess a spirit of intelligence such as mankind. When an animal dies, their soul and body ceases to exist. There is no life after death with animals. Now, you see them mounting, have the mount of their dog or their cat or so forth. And even Roy Rogers, this is going way back, unless you're older, had Trigger and had him mounted. Oh, a whole horse. And put it in their showcase there before, you know, he died and his wife died and so forth. And by the way, if you didn't know this, these were both Christians. And I have their book that she had put out, how she trusted Christ as her Savior, and him also, Roy Rogers. He was really quite a man. And but what I always liked about the movies, that they always won out. They never lost. The criminal always got arrested and put away. I wish we had some Roy Rogers and so forth around in our communities today, because I don't see anybody arresting. You can come here and you can throw all of this crap on and getting a president here for the United States, and all of your trickery and your lies that you told, and nobody got arrested. Nobody's got arrested. They come on there and you're supposed to allow to be to watch and so forth, and then they come out and take it away from you or move it back so fast you can't see what you're doing and all of that. But it didn't used to be that way. So anyway, we're going down. For thou hast said in thy heart, and we come here to the wills here and so forth, and it tells us here, it says, that Lucifer, the anointed cherub, wasn't satisfied with the original creation where he was to reign, Isaiah chapter 14, in verses 13 and 14. It describes and shows forth his free will, his conscience, his thinking and ability, and his emotions and so forth. And here are the five I wills here of Satan. For thou hast said in thy heart, I will ascend into the heaven. So that means he somewhere under heaven is where he resided. I will exalt my throne above the stars of God. Well, where's his throne at? Well, it was on the earth that God created for him. And I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation, in other words, in the sides of the north. So there was a place there for the congregation where in the sides of the north on the original creation, and I will sit also upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. There was a place ascended there where he could do the speaking and he could control the rest of those angels. And then he said, I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. So he wasn't floating around up there in some cloud or something like that. He had an earth in order to reside upon, and God made it for the angels, you see. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. Well, there's one thing about it there. He sure wasn't close to doing it. I'll be like the Most High. He wanted to be like God. Here we have the five I wills of Lucifer, Satan, who was given his residence on the original creation as recorded in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, along with the angels. In Genesis 1:1, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. Very simple. We have, therefore, God, the Holy Spirit directed Moses to use the exact Hebrew word Asa made concerning the spiritual attributes of Adam. The same Hebrew word is used in reference to Eve concerning something that previously existed. Notice in Genesis chapter 2 verse 22, and the rib which the Lord God had taken from man made, that is Asa, he, a woman, and brought her forth unto the man. Here the rib had existed before, therefore qualifying the Hebrew Asa to be used instead of the Hebrew bara created, you see. Now we go on here. Other words, notice that we have the same thing concerning Adam, who was formed out of the dust of the ground, which would prohibit the use of the word created, Hebrew bara, in reference to this. Here is the record in Genesis chapter 2, in verse 7. And the Lord God formed, that's not created, man of the dust of the ground. Since created has reference to something that had no previous existence, in usage here would be disqualified. The reason is that man was formed out of something already in existence, and that is the dust of the ground. So we use the right word. Adam and Eve, both created and made. Oh, this is really getting sort of technical, isn't it? How can it be both created and made? Well, let's see what it does. It may seem at first glance that the words created and made are used in reference to Adam and Eve may appear contradictory to each other, but since basically created has reference to something that had no previous existence and made has reference to something that did previously exist, then how could they be complementary instead of contradictory? Well, it's a pretty good question, isn't it? Well, let's go look at it and see what God has and puts in here and how does he qualify it. I believe we can summarize very simply how these two words are used in their proper context. As Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5 says, every word of God is pure. You see, the words from God to mankind in Genesis were penned by Moses exactly and precisely as the Holy Spirit directed. There's no mistake in the original Hebrew, and you can look those up. Well, I'll put these all down. 2 Timothy 3:16 there. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 20 and 21. Now, let's continue here. Genesis chapter 2, verse 3, God makes it perfectly clear that in his 6 days of remodeling a ruined and uninhabitable earth and bringing into existence humanity, he used precisely two words to distinguish any false teaching that may arise. One of those being the pseudo-philosophy of a young earth. Pseudo, when we use that, means a false philosophy made up in your own mind of a young earth of only 6,000 years old. But that's a lie. Here is the second record concerning these two important words in Genesis chapter 2 in verse 3. Here we go. God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his work, which God created, bara, and made, asa. The two words concerning this. God makes it perfectly clear concerning the 6 days of renovation that he created some things and others. He did not create, but were made, a distinction that God wants us to recognize, or that he would not have used two different Hebrew words as stated in Genesis chapter 2 in verse 3. Here we will simplify these two words as used in reference to Adam and Eve only. A very simple principle to keep in mind is the following. First, where made is used in reference to Adam and Eve, it is in reference to something that has existed before. This will be used as part of the complete embodiment of Adam and Eve. Second, when created is used in reference to Adam and Eve, it is always in reference to their completed form as Homo sapiens. Such has never existed before. So you will see this, and we examine the verses containing made and created. So that's good. Here we go. God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness, in Genesis 1:26. As you recall, image is in reference to the spiritual qualities of mankind, such as emotions, free will, personality, thinking, and so forth. As noted before, these all existed with the angels ages before. Therefore, created meaning never existed before would be disqualified. Notice carefully that God said, let us make man. Adam had not existed as yet. Here God is telling us a particular part of what the complete man will possess, that is the spiritual qualities which God had previously endowed the angels with when he created them. Very interesting. We find out here in Genesis 1:27, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him, male and female created he them. This verse differs from verse 26, as this is speaking of Adam as a completed creation. Now, if you'll notice that God created man and male Adam and female Eve created he them. Here God tells us that he has already created Adam and Eve, body, soul, and spirit. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 23. Therefore, the word create is properly justified too, as to its meaning of never previously existing, as there has never existed Homo sapiens prior to Adam and Eve. Angels are not Homo sapiens. We do know that Lucifer and the angels as we know them did possess some kind of bodies as they resided on the original creation. Ezekiel 28:14 speaks of Lucifer as, thou hast walked up and down in the midst of the stones of fire. We do know that all angels are described in the masculine gender and are called men. There are no women angels anywhere. I know that's going to break your heart, women, but we love you just the same, and you are angels to us as far as doing the job that the Lord has for you to do. I don't know what we would ever do without you. I know I don't know what I'd do without my wife. I'd be a very lonesome man, but I have a wonderful wife. She's got now she's got Parkinson's disease, which is really affecting her quite. And I hope that if you know anybody that's ever had it, it's a bad disease. I hope you would pray for Margie, my wife, because she really needs prayer and can hardly many times get out of bed and so forth. That there so. We all have some kind of physical problem, and as we get older, and we're both 85 years old, so it's getting time. We're praying, even so come, Lord Jesus, amen. Yeah, that's what we're looking forward to. So, but anyway, what kind of material the angels' bodies were composed of, we're not told. But whether whatever kind of body God created them with was not the same exact material as we possess today. God lets us know that He can create a body for whosoever or whatever species that He sees fit. And we have this in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 here in verses 38 to 40. And I want to read those to you. Because God always answers these questions here. He really does. Notice verse 38. But God giveth it a body as it hath pleased Him, and to every seed His own body. All flesh is not the same flesh, but there is one kind of flesh of men, another of flesh of beasts, another of fishes, another of birds. There are also celestial bodies, and both bodies terrestrial. But the glory of the celestial is one, and the glory of the terrestrial is another, in verse 40. Whatever species God creates, He gives it a body to function with exactly as He sees fit. Therefore, the angels had bodies, they could talk, they could walk, and function, but their bodies were different. It is true that they had the same spiritual attributes as we do know, that is, they had feelings, they had intelligence, they were created with the free will to choose right or wrong, but their bodies were different, as they were not created to reproduce. Now, keep in mind, and keep this in mind, all angels were men. God never created angels to reproduce, therefore their bodies had no use for organs of sexual reproduction, as there were no women angels ever created to reproduce with. Well, I don't know if you're teaching that in your pastors, but you surely ought to, because you're going to get some good information here on what God says. Wherefore our English created from the Hebrew bara is absolutely correct, as there has never existed a created being exactly like the Homo sapiens, such as Adam and Eve. Peter states in his second epistle, in 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 11, whereas angels which are greater in power and might, that is the Homo sapiens, you say. The foregoing makes it clear that the angels and Lucifer were created prior to mankind and inhabited the original creation, which could have been millions, billions and years ago. It could have even been 20 years ago. You know, just go to show you how foolish it is to try to say that how long is it after He destroys the earth He created for them, then how long is it going to be in this gap period before He creates mankind and gives them the job of remodeling what Satan had caused to be destroyed because of him turning against God, you see. The foregoing makes it clear that the angels and Lucifer were created prior to mankind and inhabited the original creation, which could have been, oh, they put millions and billions, and you know what, I just said that, because that's what men are trying to guess from. How long is it going to be when God put them off of the creation, the original creation, and how long is it going to be before God remodeled the earth for human beings? How is that? What length of time in between? Well, first of all, it doesn't make any difference. The Bible tells us that a day with the Lord is as a thousand years. So with God, time is not even a factor, and there's no reason to put a time in because it means nothing to you and to me or anything else. And so let's continue on. After Luther's rebellion, the earth was rendered uninhabitable, as God states in Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2. And the earth became without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep. Since it became that way, it is evident it wasn't created that way. In Isaiah 45, 18, and you want to mark this one down and have it, type the verse out, put it at the front of your Bible so that you have it. God, that's He, God, created it, the earth, not in vain. That is, He didn't create it a wilderness, a waste, and without form. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is none else. So you see, He, God, created it, the earth, not in vain. That is, a wilderness, and without form. He formed it to be inhabited. But it was a beautiful place for the angels to reside upon, and to be inhabited. I'm the Lord, there is none else. It taxes our imagination as to how beautiful God had made the original creation for Lucifer and the angels in Ezekiel 28 in verse 13. He gives a little insight as to its beauty. Now, you're men here that don't believe that at all, and they take this and apply this because some of the things that on the original creation are going to apply to things on when God remodels the earth a little bit. But here it taxes our imagination how beautiful God had made the original creation for Lucifer and the angels. Ezekiel 28:13 gives us a little insight as to its beauty. Thou, Satan, has been in Eden, the garden of God. Oh, they take that and say that that's on the, that's on the God creating the virtue. There's no earth ever created before God doing this. Thou, Satan, has been in Eden, the garden of God. Well, that's true on the remodeling of the earth and so forth. But there he's going about the original creation for Lucifer and the angels. Ezekiel 28 gives a little insight as to its beauty. So that's what it's talking about, is the original creation with Satan on it. Thou, Satan, has been in Eden, the garden of God. Well, God made it a beautiful place for Satan and the angels. And by the way, when these angels were created, there were hundreds and thousands and millions of these angels that were created. Millions upon millions upon millions. And why are you saying this? Well, let me just bring something out to you. What do you think happens here when a person dies? I mean, what do you think happens? He doesn't take the body, he takes the soul and the spirit. And that is the person. The body is only giving him a object in order to indwell so that he could relate to mankind with a human body, but the real body is the soul and spirit of the individual. And we find out that when that takes place and a person dies, do you know that the angels come down and take that person either to hell, or either to, that is hell, the lake of fire, or do they take them to heaven to be with the Lord? That's for the body present with the Lord. Of course, but the angels are very, very much, and out of all those millions and millions, can you imagine how many people die a day in this world? When they die, the angels are on the job. Now, they come, and like we've said, when you die, the angels are right there either to take you to heaven and let you meet the Lord Jesus Christ, or they'll take you to hell when you look down there and look at all of those people that are in hell and in torment. Oh, don't come down here, don't come down. Oh, but you're going down there because you never accepted the fact that Christ paid for your sins on the cross. So you're some smart aleck that's going to do it yourself. Well, you're smart enough to go to hell, aren't you? You wasn't too quick with your thinking there, Pard. So you did everything sort of, I should say, the way Satan wanted you to. You just don't have to believe the Bible because that's just not true. We're making all this up. Yeah, well, by the time you go to hell, you'll change your mind in about 2 seconds, sir. And the earth became without form and void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep. Since it became that way, it is evident that it wasn't created that way. In Isaiah 45:18, I say, take this out of your Bible, type it up, put it to the front of your Bible, because this here just it eliminates this young earth bunch of crap and nothing flat. He, that's God, created it, the earth, not in vain. That is, He didn't create it a wilderness, a waste, and without form. He formed it to be inhabited. I am the Lord, and there is none else. Now, if He formed it to be inhabited, by the time it comes to our place right here on earth here, it didn't come to our folks here to... We had to remodel it. I mean, we had to remake it. God had to remake it here for us. So it didn't come here without form or anything else there. It came here without form and void. He formed it to be inhabited. And that's what God did for the angels there. I am the Lord and there is none else. It taxes our imagination as to how beautiful God had made the original creation for Lucifer and the angels. Ezekiel 28:13 gives us a little insight as to its beauty. And here's what it says. Thou, Satan, has been in Eden, the garden of God. Yes, that's on the original creation. Every precious stone was thy covering. The sardis, the topaz, the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, the jasper, sapphire, emerald, carbuncle, gold, and the workmanship of thy tablets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created. This is the angels, sir. Ma'am, is who he's talking about. Lucifer lost it all because of his rebellion against God. Because of this, his eternal residence, along with the angels that followed him, would be eternal hell. In Matthew chapter 25, in verse 41, lets us know this. That hell, or the everlasting fire, was originally prepared for the devil and his angels that occupied the original creation. Now, I'm just going to stop a second. Did you ever stop and think when people call you there was no sin before Adam and Eve? That they were the first to sin? Well, how can this happen then? In other words, hell or the everlasting fire originally prepared for the devil and his angels that occupied the original creation. Well, the one that God gave for us to have had to be remodeled. I mean, it came as a mess. And when God got through with the angels and got them off of there, I mean, nobody could live on the earth, the original earth. Long before it was ever remodeled for Adam and Eve. Matthew also lets us know that those who rebel and refuse to accept Jesus Christ as Savior will spend eternity in the lake of fire with their father, the devil. But the point I want to make is, there had to be millions and millions and millions of these angels that were created because Satan took one-third of those, and they are your demons that you have in this world today. And they're trying to get you to go to hell too, and so forth. They don't want you to trust Christ. They want to do everything to try to get arguing about the Bible and so forth, which if you know the Bible, there's not really an argument. It's by your philosophers out here that think they know something. Some of them have never even been to any kind of Bible study or anything. And now they're on the list of Ken Ham's. I know one person that he put on there, and he had everything as far as what he did with his life and so forth in there. And now he's going to speak in school. And then he started a college, and I forget, it was a few weeks. Charged him, I think, $350 and for that, for... Just, it was unbelievable. Just hardly any time at all, just a few days. But anyway, so much for that. And the devil and the angels occupied the creation long before it was ever remodeled for Adam and Eve. So when they say, oh, it could have been 10,000 years or so, they throw that out there, a day with the Lord's 1,000 years. How do we know? If God thought it was important, He would have put 75 years. He'd have put 120 years. It doesn't make any difference, the time limit. The point is, the time came when he did what he said he would do. Then, we find out those that in Matthew also lets us know that those who rebel and refuse to accept Jesus Christ as their Savior will spend eternity in the lake of fire with their father, the devil. Notice in Revelation chapter 20 also, "Then shall he say unto them on the left hand, Depart from me, you're cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels." Read also Revelation chapter 20 verse 10, and says basically the same thing, only at a different point in time. That's amazing. But Matthew 25:41 lets us know this, that hell, or the everlasting fire, was originally prepared for the devil and his angels that occupied the original creation. Absolutely. I'm sorry, you younger people, but you are taking verses out of context, and everything that talks about the Eden and the garden, that was also on the original creation, folks, if you know your Bible. Then, your young earth advocates want you to believe that there was no sin before Adam, therefore denying the original creation where Lucifer and the angels resided. If Adam and Eve were the first to ever sin, then why wasn't hell created for Adam and Eve instead of the devil and his angels? They had to be existing prior to Adam and Eve, because that's who hell was created for. We'll expound more on this later concerning this false teaching of the young earth advocates who claim that there was no sin before Adam. I can't wait to get to that section, because that makes you look like an absolute fool. And you are. If you put out false teachings of the Bible, you're only a fool, and those that follow you are more foolish than you are. The young earth advocates claim that their interpretation of geology lives to support a 6,000-year-old earth. They absolutely refuse to acknowledge the biblical teaching of the original creation and the gap of time before God remodeled it for human habitation. This gap of time could involve millions or even billions of years, but that is not true. In other words, I'm putting in what some of your guest men are out there that think they know something, have no idea what they think they know. They just open their big mouth, their brain is closed, and they're putting out these figures which mean absolutely nothing. We have no idea of the gap period of time at all when God rendered the earth with these angels on here, rebelled against God and destroyed the creation that he had given them on a wonderful, beautiful earth. And this, they say, gives the evolutionists the time needed for evolution to take place. This philosophy is the wisdom of men, but not of God, because it denies the biblical authority of Genesis chapter 1. When God destroyed the original creation along with the beast of the earth, the cattle, and every creeping thing, he rendered it a desolation, a wilderness, and uninhabited. Now you'll notice in Genesis 1:25 that the word made is used of the animals, cattle, creeping things, not the word created. Because made in the Hebrew means bringing into existence something that had previously existed on the original creation. I stated this to make a very simple point. How in the world could something evolve when there was absolutely nothing to evolve from? That's, again, the young earth advocates project another lie, that is, that the gap principle allows time for evolution to take place, wherein the opposite is true. It would make absolutely no difference if there was 100,000, 200, or 20 million, or 50 billion years between God's judgment and the original creation and remodeling it for human habitation, you see. Excluding the angels becoming disembodied spirit, all other forms of life and vegetation were completely destroyed, as Genesis 1:2 states, and the earth became without form and void. Therefore, as I've said before, how can something evolve from something when there was nothing to evolve from? This in itself disproves any possibility of evolution having taken place. None. All of this young earth philosophy stems from not accepting the Bible authority of God's word concerning the original creation and the gap of time between God remodeling it for human habitation. Maybe if some of these men would spend the majority of their time studying the Word of God instead of digging in the dirt, they wouldn't have to distort the Bible into fitting the so-called geological findings and so forth here. Now, we're going to stop there, see how our time is running here. but we're going to stop there. And I don't want to go and start in on the next thing that we want to show, that these men that are against the original creation there with the ones on there that are there. But anyway, saying that there's no sin before Adam is the claim of the false teachings of the young earth advocates. They base their claim on Romans 5:12, which reads, and I'm going to stop right there because I want to start on this next week. I really do. And you'll see the lies that these people tell that just slaps them right in the face. They don't know what to do with it. And if you're in a church where your pastor doesn't teach this stuff, you're just leading people right down a stormy road, because they're not going to have an answer to give to anybody except what they've been taught, but they've been taught wrong. So we say that. Now, in closing, let me say this to you. It's wonderful because it amazes me every time I read the Bible and study it, how God covers every little avenue that we have or things that you wanted to know. Here he puts it in there and puts it out, the difference between made and so forth, and the two words. It's just amazing. But you have to go back to the Hebrew in order to get the official meaning of what was written in the Masoretic text there, in the original text, and translated into, sometimes your King James will make a mistranslation. Now, don't faint now down there, you King James, that think the Bible is, you know, the Word of God, right down. I'm going to say this, it is, I have many, many translations in my office and so forth that I've kept, collect them, and I would check them and so forth. The translation here of the King James is by far superior to anything. The New King James is a mess. And why would you have a New King James when you got the best of the King James of the original? But the New King James and so forth, it's just amazing how you screw things up instead of teaching what you already have, and then make out if there's a mistake in the King James, and yes, there are a few mistakes, but they're not ones that have to do with the real doctrine. All of these are that, but there's not a lot of them. But it is the best by far out there on the thing for you to get. If you're going to buy a Bible, I would get the King James translation. Don't get the New King James, because the newer got to be worse than what the original was, so don't fall for that garbage. Now, the big lie, no sin before Adam, Romans 5:12. It's going to be very interesting. Do you see how can these people and these preachers lie about this, because they follow Ken Ham. They just follow him. And what he does, he doesn't talk about these things, because he only came and there's things that he won't. I've asked him, what do you think about the rapture, Ken? Well, he has his representative put on the phone then, and so forth. He just deals with people who don't want him to believe in evolution, but God created and so forth. But he puts all this other garbage in there and so forth. What do you think about 7-year tribulation period? What do you think about the 1,000-year reign? And I had one thing that I had sent for and got from him. And he went through his thing. He's put out the new creation one now, but he took off the end of the one previous. And after he goes through all of that and so forth, he comes down to where at the end there, he says, because I ask him, what do you think about the 1,000-year reign of Christ and so forth? He don't answer any of that, because he doesn't believe that stuff. He doesn't believe in the rapture. He doesn't believe the 7-year tribulation period. He doesn't believe in the 1,000-year reign of Christ on the earth. He doesn't believe any of that. The one that I had, I've been trying to find that since, is where he came out and said, when Christ comes back and so forth there, when Christ comes back, then it's going to be all different. It's going to be all different and so forth. And when he comes back, that's it. That's the end. When he goes back to the earth, then whoever is saved goes to heaven, whoever is lost goes to hell. Nothing about the 1,000-year reign of Christ or anything, nothing about 7-year tribulation period, nothing about that at all. That's how you pervert the Word of God, and these people do that, and the majority, I'm going to say, do it, because I think one of the things I get as a pastor Do you know of a good Bible teaching church? Not really. You know, I do the best I can, but I can think of one here or that. I suppose there are some, but I'm down in Minnesota, and I have enough trouble here trying to make it clear that Martin Luther and all that, this guy sent millions of people to hell, and he's still doing it today. And if you bring that out, what happens is they'll try to destroy you. When I bring that out like that, well, I looked, of course, this is down through time. There was my dumpster behind the church, and they had dumped that on the ground and turned the dumpster upside down. That's nice of them, wasn't it? I had a lady tell me when she seen where they took in the wintertime, instead of where we come out and put our stuff in, they picked up our dumpster and moved it clear over to the side of a building over there where we couldn't get to it in the wintertime, and so we couldn't use it. And she seen who did it and told me, but she said, if you, I live in Walnut Grove, but if you tell who did it, they will hate me or do anything to me, because I told who did it and exposed who it was. I have hardly ever got anybody with the things that I've had and experienced in Walnut Grove to ever been certified corrupt, or I'm not saying corrupted, but found out who did it and so forth. And if so, nothing ever happens. Nothing. And so forth. But anyway, in closing, let me say the most important decision you'll ever make of your life is God said, I love the world and I give my only begotten Son, as Jesus Christ, that whosoever believeth in Him. Do you believe that He came from heaven to earth? Well, your time's dated from Him, you know. It's so-and-so date, A.D., that's Latin for Anno Domini, the year of our Lord. Every time you sign a date, it's proof that Jesus Christ came from heaven to earth and dated from His time and so forth. You got to believe something, and I hope that you do. But God's made it perfectly clear that God loves you so much that He came from heaven, He went to the hell of the cross, so you wouldn't have to go to hell and pay for your sins in hell for all time and eternity with never a chance to get out. He did it so that you would be free and paid for your sin on the cross, and all you have to do is accept it by believing it's true. That's all. So don't promise, oh, I'm going to live a better life. It'll never take you to heaven. Or you know what, I tell you, I came forward and showed that I believe that Christ paid for my sins. Maybe you're saved, maybe you're not. I don't know. But you don't have to go forward to do it. And Mr. Preacher, why don't you tell them just how to go to heaven and let them sit where they sit? I'm against that because I'm one that walked out. And you're telling me how simple it is to have eternal life. And then when you give the invitation, you want me to get out of my seat and walk forward? But I found out why that is. So it would show people, and they could put in their bulletin, how many he led to Christ last Sunday. Sure, he can put it in. It makes him look good, doesn't it? Doesn't that make him look good? I come with wonderful teaching here, and they come forward to get saved. What about the ones that don't want to come forward, sir? Are you going to let them go to hell because they won't do what you don't have to tell them they have to do in order to have eternal life? If you really mean it, you'll step out of that seat and come forward. Well, what about the person that doesn't want to come out of your seat and come forward, but you know what? We really mean it, that I would like to just believe that Jesus Christ paid for my sins and let me have it there and give me eternal life when there's nothing I can do, including coming to the front of a church. What about that, Mr. Preacher? You're preaching a false lie that has sent a lot of people right straight to hell that thinks they have to go forward in a church, and I don't know how many down through the years that I've been a pastor that has told me, if you think I'm getting up in front of all them people and walking down forward, you mean, and then you just said about, you know, there's nothing you have to do. It's easiest anything, just believe. Then you give the invitation, you got to get up out of your seat and walk forward. You don't have to do that, folks, ever. The only thing you have to do is, you believe that God loved the world and gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him would never perish but have everlasting life. God loved the world and gave His only begotten Son. Whosoever believeth in Him never perish but have everlasting life. It's that simple. You can do nothing to go to heaven except accept what Christ did for you, and he paid for your sin so you don't have to go to hell and do it yourself. And he offers it as a free gift. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Romans 3:23, wages of sin is death, but the gift of God. We've all sinned, Romans 3:23, we've all sinned, come short of the glory of God. Romans 6:23 says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. That gift makes it payable when you're going to give away a gift. You must have to purchase what you bought to give away. Christ came from heaven to earth to die on the cross so he could give his life, paying for your sin, so you wouldn't have to go to hell and do it yourself. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Saved from what? Saved from hell. I hope that you will trust him. And I hope it is so simple. I thank God. When I almost died as a stupid teenager in a car wreck, my knife goes through the window, cuts it from there to the jugular vein, almost died. I'd been in hell all these years. I about get choked up when I stop to think about it. How you saved me from that. I've been in hell all these years, Lord. Thank you for saving me alive. You never know when something may happen to where you'll be leaving this earth, maybe accidentally, maybe get in a bad car wreck. It wasn't your fault. We don't know, and I hope that never happens to you. But I hope something never happens to you that you'll go to hell with your sins already paid for as a free gift to God to give to you because he paid for your hell instead of you going to do it yourself. Thank you for joining us. And we always like to take and make that out simple without any gimmicks that churches put into that to go to heaven. The only way you go to heaven is believe that God paid for your sins. And he did. And the evidence is the time that we get, that we live in today, is dated from Jesus Christ. Thank you for being with us this morning. We count it our privilege to come into your home and spend this time with you. It's been truly our privilege. Thank you for the wonderful things and responses that we get for the broadcast. And we just think and thank the Lord we have an opportunity to bring these things here, because I've been lied to as a boy from preachers, and I don't want to do that to the people at all. You're very important. Thank you for being a listener to our broadcast that we put out. And we do love you and thank you for the privilege to do so. Pray for us that we'll continue and be able to keep these broadcasts on the air and to pay for them and so forth. Thank you for joining today. Look forward to a wonderful week next week. And it could be the week that even so come Lord Jesus. Boy, wouldn't that be wonderful? Whoa, we're in heaven. I mean, that's it. Wouldn't that be wonderful? So look forward to seeing you next week. Have a wonderful week. Thank you for being our crowd or our ones that listen to the service. We appreciate it greatly. Thank you. God bless you.